Surely. So good morning, everyone. I welcome you all on behalf of AIODC. So I welcome Dr. Sneha Batra and Dr. Aditi Ghosh, our moderators for the session. So I request Dr. Sneha to take over from here and start the session.
Thank you so much, Anasha. So good morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to all of you in this new session at AIOC called Challenges from the Learner's Basket. So this is a session where our young challengers from different subspecialties are going to share their experiences where on one particular day they had to face this challenging case, this complicated case, and they had to come out of the shadows of their mentors and manage this case on their own. And we also have an excellent panel, some very reputed senior national faculty who are going to empower our young mentees with their expert tips and tricks on how to best manage such situations. We are also extremely privileged to have some of the best and most renowned teachers with us as chairpersons who are going to be our guiding light today. So I would like to introduce our chairpersons, starting with Dr. O.K. Radhakrishnan. Sir is the professor of ophthalmology at Dr. D.Y. Patil Medical College, Pune. He has been a colonel in the Indian Army he had retired after 25 years of service to the Indian Army. He has multiple national and international papers. And more than anything, if you ask any of his students, he is one of the most loved and respected teachers. So, sir, are you there?
Yeah, I'm there. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Next, we have as the chairperson, Dr. Parvez Alam, sir. He is the director of Noor Eye Care, Kakinara, West Bengal. He has been a cataract surgeon for the last 18 years. And again, one of the most humble people and one of our most favorite people. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
Next on the chair, we have Dr. Mandar Paranjpe, sir. He is the editor of Blink newsletter of Maharashtra Ophthalmological Society, the associate member, managing committee, MOS. He is running a chain of three clinics in Pune city, Talegaon, Dabhare, and Lonavala, and also the reviewer of Indian Journal of Ophthalmology. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you very much.
And last but not the least, we have Dr. Vaishali Une, madam. She is the associate professor at SBH Government Medical College, Dhule. She has a teaching experience of more than 23 years. She is the president of Aurangabad Ophthalmological Association. She is the SC member of Maharashtra Ophthalmological Society and the Maharashtra State Chapter of ISMSIS. And she is my fellow LDPN. So a very warm welcome to you, madam.
Thank you, Neha. Thank you so much.
So we would like to start the session, and Dr. Aditi and I will be the moderators for this session. Dr. Aditi, I would like to hand over to you to start the session with the first talk on the cataract subspecialty.
Thank you so much, Neha. So we'll start our session on cataract. Our speaker is Dr. Shivashish Das. Shivashish, you can start sharing your screen. He's a young, vibrant cataract refractive surgeon from Kolkata. We all know him for his wonderful, fabulous, challenging cases. And he's always, he's a very good speaker as well. And our panelist for this session is Dr. Somil Kathari, sir, a medical director of Bombay City Eye Center and Research Institute and assistant editor of cataract section in IJO. We all know Somil, sir. So I'll pass on the batter over to you. Shivashish, can you hear me?
Yes. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, Aditi Didi, for this wonderful introduction.
Thanks. And
welcome to all the esteemed panelists and seniors who are here. So today, I'd like to discuss in a case of runner excess. So always our excess do not go as planned. In many cases of intumescent or hypermature cataracts, we have cases of in which the excess runs away. So in these cases, if the conditions permit, can we not convert this to ascites, and can we continue with the phaco? So that is what I would like to discuss in this video. This is one of the first cases which I had encountered. After that, over the period of 3-4 years, I've encountered two such more cases. So here, this cataract, it was a very hypermature intumescent cataract, where first I stained the capsule for a good period of time with glue. And then I would like to, I always try to do a two-step rexis in cases of intumescent cataracts. So first you like to do a small rexis, debulk the lens matter, take out some cortical matter, with irrigation aspiration, and then I try to do a second stage Rexis because that becomes much more controlled as the intralenticular pressure goes down. So our Rexis is much more controlled. Here I'm doing the first smaller Rexis. So the smaller Rexis could be fairly controlled, and here we have a small sized Rexis. So after doing irrigation aspiration to take out some of the cortical matter, we make a small snip in the anterior capsule, and with the help of Rexis forceps, we try to complete the Rexis. Now, in this case, I'll just show what my mistake was. While completing the Rexis, it is, in cases of beginner surgeons, it is good to, we tend to re-grab the flap repeatedly, but I would advise is to continue with your flap as much as you can to complete the Rexis. Do not leave and re-grab repeatedly. Here, in this situation, what the mistake I did was, I did not complete the Rexis and I left it there. And there we can see here at this moment, the Rexis has gone away. The margin is no longer here and the Rexis has gone away. So it is all a lost situation right now. The Rexis has already run out. So after trying also, I could not retrieve the Rexis. So now what can I do? I just trim away the tag of the Rexis that I had. Now I try to make a new nick here. So that I can complete the Rexis somehow, leaving a weaker end on the other side. So here I would like to fold the tag on itself, and by a gentle pull towards the center, I could complete the Rexis, but we have a weaker dehiscence here. The Rexis has already gone away. So in this case, I make some relaxing incisions, puncture marks, exactly opposite to the direction of where my Rexis has run out, because I want to do a phaco in this case and I don't want the traction to fully go on that side. I reduce the bottle height to about 50% of what I normally use, and I keep my parameters low. I will try not to manipulate much. In this case, I also try to charge less amount of phaco. I'll try to feed in the nuclear pieces to my phaco tip. I have edited and I have bits of parts to make the video smaller. So here I remove the portions of the nucleus. I try to feed the nucleus in my phaco probe, charging as much less ultrasound as possible and keeping the fluid pressure low. So like this, we can see that we have almost removed 80% of our nuclear material. And in this case, one of the main thing is that we have to be very patient. Patience is the key. So if you are patient, now we have seen, now we can see that we have successfully removed the lens.
Sorry to interrupt you, but we have limited time for each presentation. So I request you to please
mind. Yeah. So as we see in this presentation, we can do a phaco in a case where Rexis has run away. Thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you so much. Over to you, Somil sir.
So very good presentation, very good video, Dr. Shivashish. And I must congratulate you for completing the case quite well. A few points which I would just like to make out here is, one is, how do we prevent runaway Rexis? And the second is, what to do in case if we do have a runaway Rexis? Right. So in your case, you prefer that you make a smaller Rexis first and then you debulk the anterior cortex and then you carry on making a nick and a second Rexis. So what that is one way of going about it, of course. But what I prefer is using a good high molecular weight visco OVDs. And then with the pressure of the OVDs, the high molecular weight, like I have no final interest, but Helon, GV, Helon would work very well out here. And having sort of compressed the or equalized the internal lenticular and external forces, the Rexis can be completed quite well. So this is what my preferred option is, not to make two Rexis, but just to complete it in one go itself. Second, I would just humbly disagree with what you said. Is what you said is that you should go and extend the access as much as possible. I am of the old school that I would release and re-grasp the rexes at multiple points for the exact same reason that I want a very controlled rexes in this situation. I don't want even a slightest amount of extension. So what I would do is just hold the rexes, extend it to my controlled manner, release it, re-grasp it, propagate it forward, release, re-grasp, propagate forward. I don't want to go more than one or two clock hours at a time. That will ensure that the control is there at all times. If necessary, please refill the anterior chamber with OVDs at appropriate amount, at appropriate time periods. Third is about when you do have a situation of a runaway rexus, you have placed relaxing incision at multiple points. My approach would be slightly different. And I have seen that relaxing incisions themselves, they tend to run away sometimes. And you have now a 2-point runaway rather than only 1 point. So you are having a more of a headache. So what I would generally do is I would assess first whether the rexus has gone right up to the posterior pole or it's just round about the equator. And having ascertained, having my phaco probe put inside the anterior chamber and having being confident that the rex has not gone away posteriorly, I would, as you rightly said, lower down the parameters of aspiration flow rate, of vacuum, of the bottle height, see that you have a slow motion phaco, have a controlled manner. There should not be any fluctuations in the anterior chamber itself, and complete the endonucleus removal. After endonucleus removal, it's very important not to remove the phaco probe as you've done, but I would immediately put in OVDs on the side port in order to stabilize the anterior chamber before removing the phaco probe. So that's very important because sudden debulking of the anterior chamber can, the rexus can extend posterior. So these are my points from the video which you just showed. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Somil, sir. Thank you so much. That's why we have this session, to learn from the best in their field. Thank you so much. May I now request our chairperson, Parvez sir, to add on to this topic? Parvez, are you there?
Yes. First of all, I will congratulate Dr. Shiva Siddharth for wonderful presentation. Actually, what I will do in such cases, I will try to just fill up the anterior chamber with OVDs, and I especially use PESCO. So in such situations, I will put some PESCO. And if there is any pressure over the eyeball by speculum or whatever it is, I will try to loosen it. I will calm down. And after that, I do rexis with capsulotome. So with the capsulotome, I think I will be able to manage this case. But if not, what Dr. Shivashish Das did, with low parameters, the phaco can be completed. And if at all, I have experience whether I'll be able to do phaco in such cases, if the situation arises, I will simply convert to SICS because that is one situation in which such problems can be easily solved. But Dr. Shivashish did very well, and I think he did wonderful surgery.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir. A lot. Thank you, Shivashi. Thank you, Somil, sir. Thank you, Parvez, sir. Over to you, Sneha, for our next case.
Yeah, sorry to interrupt. Just a question, that how long do we have Q&A after each presentation? The time?
6 minutes.
Around six.
6 minutes for the Q&A and four minutes for the presentation.
For the presentation. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. So do we have the speakers and the panelists ready for the vitro retina one? Dr. Maharshi, are you there?
Sneha, I need to take the leap because I have another presentation.
Yes, yes. Thank you so much, Shivashish.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming. Dr. Maharshi, are you there? No, I think he was traveling.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. She is there.
Okay, I think Maharavi sir has also joined. So we can take a block of as well. Okay.
Perfect.
Tomonash, are you there?
Yeah, I'm there.
Okay, then let us have the glaucoma talk now. So our speaker for this talk is Dr. Tomonash Basu. He is currently working as an associate consultant at Shankar Netralay, Kolkata. He has multiple publications to his name. And for those who know him personally, he's also a very good quizzer and a quiz master. So Tomonash, over to you.
Is my screen visible?
No, sir. Yeah, it, yeah. Now it's visible.
Okay. Very good afternoon to everyone. I'd like to thank Dr. Aditi, Dr. Sneha, and the whole AIS team for including me in this wonderful session, this indulging session. So I'd like to show a video of AGB implantation. This is the case where repeat trabeculectomy was done. These are the previous two trabeculectomies was done. And what all challenges I faced during the AGB tube implantation, that I will be showing here. So I have fast forwarded a part where it was not necessary. I will show the important parts on the, it is edited video. So first of all, I check the whether the conjunctiva is mobile or not. Then I may make a peritomy at around 2 mm from the limbus, 2 to 3 mm from the limbus. I'd like to know the expert's opinion regarding this also, because there are two schools of thought, one in the making the incision at limbus and one 2 to 3 mm away from the limbus, which serves them better. So I made an incision around 2 to 3 mm away from the limbus. Then the first problem I faced during the AGB implantation is this anchorage suture. You can see there are two traps here. There is a dearth of space actually. So when I am doing this, passing this thread, I had a problem for visualization. So I took a muscle hook and I asked my secretary to grasp it and retract the conjunctiva. Then only I got a good view, and then only I started the suturing. So what their thought and what they do in this sort of kind of scenarios where the eye is crowded and there is a not much space, I would like to know that. Then after the cutting the tube, the main step comes to insert the tube in the anterior chamber. So the textbook teaches us that it should be a sharp entry around 2 to 2.5 mm behind the limbus through a 23 gauge needle. I did that. But what happens is when I grasped the tube and I was trying to push it, it was not going in. I struggled. I pushed it here, but it was not going in. Then again, I came out and I tried again. It was not going in then also. Then I came again out again. I tried again and again. And now this time it was going into the sulcus. I made a false entry. It's not visible here, but actually the iris was tenting up. So I went to sulcus. There was a chance of lens injury also. So I got a little scared. I went and enlarged the needle track. And I know this is a controversial. I should not have done that. But for the entry of tube, I had to do that, and I inserted a tube. Now this has gone nicely. So what their thought regarding this step? And after that, we know we have to stop the tube erosion through the conjunctiva. So you have to place a graft. Before the corona period, we used to use the corneal graft for this AGV to graft the tube. But now, when the cornea is not available, use the sclera, and it is very thick and tough structure. You can see that I am struggling actually to pass the needle, and I have to pass it through four places, to anchor it in four places. So it's a very difficult thing to anchor the sclera. So if the expert panel can tell what else I could have done, other than using the sclera for this thing, that would have been beneficial. So I have done the scleral patch graft over the tube. And the last problem what I faced during the AGV surgery is the conjunctival retraction. Previously, before I used to have a continuous suture all along this section, but it used to gape because of the conjunctival retraction. So what I started to doing is two interrupted suture and then continue the rest with the continuous suture. And I generally give doxycycline at the end. So I'd like the expert panel's comment regarding that also. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Ramanash. So in the panel for glaucoma discussion, we have Dr. Kumar Ravi, sir. He is the consultant glaucoma services at BBI Foundation, VIP and Netralayam, Kolkata. He has multiple publications to his credit. So, sir, over to you.
Thank you, Sneha, and thank you, Aditi, for having me in the team. And thank you, AIOS, for giving me this opportunity. Dr. Tamunash, excellent surgery, first of all. There is hardly anything to add from my side because this kind of trivial struggles all of us have at one time or the other. Just to add a few things here and there, usually I make my conjunctival incision exactly around 4 to 5 millimeter away from the limbus. The advantage that I get is that it is equidistant from the anterior entry and the posterior side wherein we have to suture the valve, body of the valve with the sclera. So the exposure is quite good if we are 4 millimeters away. Another advantage is that when we close it by the suturing, the next morning the patient is comfortable, because if we have sutures at the limbus, the patient is uncomfortable, watering is more. And if it is little away, then usually the discomfort is less. This is the first point. Second point is while starting the surgery, I usually take two fixing sutures. One is cordial fixing suture and one is superior rectus. And for cordial fixing suture, I was seeing that when you were doing surgery, the eye was continuously moving. It was not fixed properly. So with the movement of the patient's body or head, there was some kind of movement which was creating trouble when we were putting the body of the valve inside the conjunctival pocket. So what I do usually is I ask for two assistants, and one assistant is there to hold this corneal traction suture all the time, especially when I'm putting the valve and suturing the valve with the underlying sclera. At that particular time, I ask for two assistants. Coming to the entry point, what I saw is we were entering little diagonally. There must have been some reason for that, but how I make my entry is with a 24 gauge needle. I make straight stab incision kind of incision, just like we do while making a side port. The advantage that I get with that is that the track is very small. The entry of the AGV tube is exactly at the desired angle and the way you want it to go. That is number one. And then I use a special instrument which comes with the same company which manufactures this device, which gives a good grip over the tip of the instrument. One more extra thing which I do is I go with bevel down approach. If just imagine when you're rotating the tube, bevel down, then the tip of the AGV cut tube is in the upper part. So even if it goes and hits or goes very close to the iris, then now the natural tendency of the tube is to, you know, just climb over and go into the anterior chamber. If the bevel is down, then it tends to penetrate into the iris and go into the sulcus, which, you know, some of many of us face. So if we keep bevel down, then usually we enter directly into the anterior chamber. And coming to the points that you've discussed now, like regarding if there's a difficulty in suturing, we can also consider hangback technique, wherein we don't suture the valve. We just put the sutures to the AGV tube and like hope that it stays there. That is one thing. Second thing is what I have modified in my technique of AGV is while I'm putting the scleral patch graft, I put the scleral patch graft, the rectangular part, if you see, the breadth one, the one which is wider, that I put facing the limbus. Okay, so that covers the tube well, and the chances of mobility of that scleral patch graft is less. So that gives a good, you know, cover to the tube, and we hope that it will not expose the tube in future, even if it is a little bit moves here and there. And with this technique, I have been able to reduce the number of fixating sutures to only two. This I pre-place beforehand, like before doing the surgery only, I keep my scleral patch graft ready with two fixed sutures. So a large graft, put it over the tube, one fixating suture on one side and other on the other side. And if I have an availability of glue, then I use glue. I sometimes totally avoid the use of sutures because sutures, yes, it sometimes messes up the surgery. So if it is available, well and good, go and just use a glue. And even if you have like access to glue sometimes, then you can even close the conjunctiva with the help of glue. There's a cost factor involved, but if the patient can afford it, the comfort that you get in the post-op period is just excellent. You will have, the post-op outlook is something similar to, I would say, a topical phaco surgery rather than an SICS kind of a surgery. But then if it is not available, two sutures for fixating, that suffices. And I think like, no, the surgery was well done. So there's very little to add, just a few heat tips here and there.
Thank you so much, sir. We would also like a quick comment from Dr. Manda Paranjpe, sir. So sir, we know that in glaucoma fellowships, the exposure to valve surgeries are not so much. So any tips that you would like to give to our youngsters who are going to start with valve surgeries for the first time? And what is the difference in starting with the AGV and the ADI implant?
Thank you very much. I personally don't have any experience of ADI implant, but valve surgeries themselves are a tricky business. So with any other surgery, one has to have a good mentor standing by you for performing a successful surgery. You have to keep in mind all the steps which have been very beautifully elucidated by both the earlier speakers while doing this kind of surgery. And particularly in this particular surgery, in which two trabs had failed. So we have this conjunctival scarring as an important factor, which can complicate or make things difficult. So you have to keep that in mind as well. So while training for any surgery, one has to have a good mentor who can guide you in performing the surgery. Stick to the basics. Don't try to be too experimental in performing these surgeries. And keep in mind the complicating factors that you are dealing with. So pre-op analysis and pre-op discussion with your seniors probably will help in giving good outcomes.
Thank you so much for that enlightening discussion, sir. So we move on to pediatric ophthalmology next. Aditi?
Yeah. So our next speaker is Dr. Nilotparna Deori. She is a young active speaker in YOSI. She is trained from Sri Shankara from Guwahati in pediatric ophthalmology, strabismus, and neuro-ophthalmology. And our expert panel is none other than Dr. Anuradha Chandra, ma'am, who is a chief consultant and in pediatric ophthalmology, strabismus, and neuro-ophthal at Shushrut Eye Care Foundation in Kolkata. She is an executive member of OSWB and also editorial board of Journal of OSWB. Over to you, Nilotparna.
Thank you so much, Dr. Aditi. So I thank AIOS for giving me this opportunity. Respected members of the panel, today I shall be talking about pediatric cataract with a pre-existing posterior capsular defect. So as we all know about pediatric cataract causes visual disability and has neurobiological developmental issues with the child. So early diagnosis and prompt surgical intervention cannot be underestimated. A thorough ocular evaluation, including the onset and morphology of the cataract, especially so when there is a pre-existing capsular defect, is a nightmare for intraoperative nightmare for a novice surgeon. Usually, these were described as thin semi-transparent membrane loosely attached to the surrounding posterior capsule. There are some case reports also where bilateral congenital PCDs in the absence of posterior polar or polar cataract or lenticonus were also described. And there are also cases where posterior lenticonus may be associated with the disease. So without going into further things, let me describe the surgery. So as we can see, this case appears to be like a lamellar cataract. And I was not expecting that I was thinking that it was a lamellar cataract. So after a good trypan blue wash in this cataract, you can see the density in the center is more, and in the periphery, it is a little less transparent. Here I'm aiming for, after the OBT injection, I'm aiming for a 5 millimeter rexis, but what I have done here is a hydrodissection, which I should not have done, and later I converted into a hydro delineation. And keeping the parameters low, I have used a 23-gauge vitrectomy system, and I'm aspirating from the peripheral part of the cataract, that is the cortex first, so that I get a epinuclear cushion during the procedure. So when I'm taking out the dense nuclear part, I could see that there is a posterior capsular dehiscence, which the area of which is almost proportional to the dense nuclear fragment. So this is also known as the slow motion phaco emulsification or aspiration with the 23 gauge vitrectomy system. This system has given me an advantage, added advantage, that I can do the anterior vitrectomy in the same sitting. And before taking out the anterior chamber maintainer, I have given in the OVD. Since the PC defect in this case for me was a little less, smaller than that of the CCC, so I have decided that I would like to go ahead with a single piece foldable acrylic hydrophobic IOL. Now, the main aim was to keep the turbulence low during the emulsification and maintain the chamber. Here I'm keeping in mind that I should not rotate the IOL, rather just tuck in the haptics into the capsularium that is left. So after a good OVD wash, I inject some amount of pilocarpine and I close the wound. So I see that the pupil is round, illustrating that there is no amount of vitreous loss. So apart from the diagnostic signs, what I feel important is that the preoperative biometric, especially the lens thickness, may give a morphometric characteristic of the posterior capsular defect in these cases, which may look like a lamellar cataract or which may have a total cataract appearance. So these were the surgical tips I had applied in this case. And thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Parma for the wonderful case. And Radha ma'am, you would like
thank
to
you, thank you. Thank you, Aditi, and thank you, Sneha, for making me the part of your team. So Nilutparna, I should definitely congratulate you. You have done a very good job. And I would be sharing some pictures. So I have made a small presentation. I would like to share with you the salient points in this case. So first is getting a pre-existing dehiscence. If you can be prepared to see that the patient already has a pre-existing dehiscence, then you are not caught with surprise during the surgery. So having a conical shape of posterior capsule, or now we have a 25 megahertz B-scan, which can delineate the posterior dehiscence with some vitreous opacities, which you can usually found in our normal ultrasound as well. And you may go for an ASOCT in which you have adhesions between the subcapsular cortex and the posterior capsule, which can tell you that this patient can have a pre-existing dehiscence. So coming to techniques, you have done wonderfully, Nilutparna. There are some advantages of having a pediatric eye with PPC, because there is an absence of nucleus, so you don't have to worry about the hydrodelineation. You can even go straight with your vitrectomy and remove it. And there is a tight, well-formed hyaloid face with a vitreous gel. So with liquefaction, which is present in the adults, it's not there. So we have less problems of drop-ups. From the techniques, you have done wonderfully. First, you start with the periphery. You clear up the periphery before disturbing the central plaque and maintain the AC pressure like you have done with your AC chamber maintainer. And you can also use a high molecular weight viscoelastics, which can also help you if you don't have a AC maintainer. And definitely, you should have a multi-piece IOL. You can put a single piece, because we do PCC in all our cases and we do use single piece IOL, so we can do that. If required, you can have a multi piece IOL in your hand if required. And
thank you so much, ma'am.
Ma'am, may I now request? Thank you so much, ma'am, for the wonderful discussion. So may I now request Vaishali ma'am to add on to this?
Firstly, I would like to congratulate Dr. Nilutparna for wonderfully handling this case. It was really well managed, beautifully done, and expert comments by Dr. Anuradha. She also have made a presentation, so everything has been summed up. I would just like maybe, I don't know, I'm not sure, because speaking on a platform and doing the case is totally different thing, but I might have softened the nucleus a little bit with the Simcoe cannula maybe, and so that removing it, try to keep the, if at all there is some few PCO, because we need to remove the PC also. But and another thing I would have done is, like, it was very well managed, but bag in the IOL, so I would have tried to keep the optics well encompassed with the posterior capsular rim. That's all. Wonderfully done. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Lovely case, lovely discussion. Over to you, Sneha, for our next case.
Thank you, Alfie. So, refractive surgery, I think our panelist is not here. Is the retina speaker ready? Dr. Maharshi, are you there? Okay, so let us take up the refractive surgery talk only then. Nishant, you are ready with your talk? Thank you so much. Two thumbs up.
Yeah.
So Nishant is a dear friend, let me start with that, and a fellow LDPN. He is the medical director at MNI Hospital. And more than anything else that is written on his CV, he is a big tennis enthusiast. So in between all his tennis, he sometimes gets time for the refractive surgery, and we'll see one of his challenging cases today. Over to you, Nishant.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, team. Instead of just one challenging case, I just have few tips before we do a challenging case. Yeah. So always I have something which I always tell all my trainees is, if you have never made a mistake, you have never tried anything new. But before you try anything new, make sure that you know a lot about the old, so that you make a mistake in the new, you always have something old to fall back on. So three mistakes I learned from is, in refractive, you always have preoperative, intraoperative, and postoperative. Something small as the pupil diameter. Normal optic zone is 6.3, but this patient has 6.47. So preoperatively, you assess and then increase it. It's much more better. Always go into additional evaluation like jaw profile and the need for LASIK and the psychological profile, which is very important. Make sure everything is transparent. Always you should make sure that the patient should not get 100% guarantee that they're going to get back a complete vision, because you always have anxious patients. I always tell them there is no 100% guarantee, but I will do my best, so does the machine. So this is a case which I wanted to share, a simple mixed astigmatism, and all the parameters are perfect for both the eyes. Before were the days when I used to enter my LASIK theater like this. Scrub, everything ready, go straight, directly go, sit and operate. So then I started to realize that patient which I had operated had a residual power of one spiracle after a month. Oh my God. So what next? And why is that? I have two air conditions. One is the slit, and the one is the window one. So look at the humidity, which was 72%. So now what do I do nowadays is, never scrub and go in. Look for the temperature. Look for the AC. Check the humidity. See which AC is on and which AC is off. Always make sure that you get everything right before you start itself, and let it end up with a lot of change. So always be the change. Check for the fluence, temperature, humidity, foot size, and everything, and get it ready. So just a small intraoperative surgery, which I wanted to show. Once, sometimes we take the flap, you know that I see that while I'm going to lift the flap, it is only half. If it is crossing the pupil axis, never continue with the surgery. Always put the flap back, repose it, put a BCL, and then explain to the patient that you're going to do it as the next step. In a case of femto, the advantage is that even if the patient moves when there is a suction loss, you can see that the loss is there. You can always dock back, do the parameters perfectly, and you can see that it actually goes along the same plane. That's one of the advantages of the femto LASIK over the blade LASIK. Because once you do a blade, you can never do a recut. It's always better to wait for around a month or two and do a surface ablative treatment. Postoperatively, what you see is sometimes you have an epithelial ingrowth. So always make sure that you lift the flap near the growth. I'll always lift whole, but before I make sure that the epithelium goes more inside, I just make sure that I rip off that epithelium in that area alone first, which comes out neatly. And then you should know that along the edge, there's going to be a lot of epithelium ingrowth. Use of Excel sponge. And then you can lift the flap, and the rest of the areas, you give a complete wash, and then you place the bandage contact lens. So post-operatively, always meet the attender and patient, grade their pain, slit lamp evaluation, instructions, apply the first drop yourself where they get confident on you. And always I check for vision with both eyes. So always cross-check everything, make a checklist where you have something which is done. Do not skip any step in refractive surgery. I'm sure that none of the surgeries you should skip, but this is something where you can't afford to skip even a single step. And there's always someone to blame for the mistakes that happens in the theater. that is yourself. So make mistakes, but learn from them. Thank you.
Excellent presentation, Nishan. Can I request Dr. Saumil sir to please comment on this and give our young refractive surgeons some tips on how to handle these traumatized flaps?
Thank you so much. And hi, Nishant, how are you?
Good, Saumil sir.
Yeah, great. So points well taken, points well showcased, right? Right from preoperative, intraoperative to postoperative management. These are points which are oftenly not highlighted. And I would say that it's good that you brought about the points about air conditioning, fluence, how to check it out yourself. And till date, personally, I always enter all the data in the machine myself. I don't rely upon my assistants to do that. In case if you're doing that, please recheck the data. As you said correctly, there's only one person to blame, that is yourself. So see that you are doing everything. Otherwise, the points are quite well taken and they're perfect.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. I just wanted to highlight those points that we tend to miss. I mean, managing a complication is good. I mean, preventively itself, you can prevent, I mean, with the machines which are there now and the expert hands of all the surgeons, very rarely you get a lot of complication nowadays compared to what it was 10, 15 years ago. Because preoperatively, we tell them a strict no. If it's going to be very flat or very steep and all that nowadays.
So we've all grown wary of preoperative assessments.
Yes.
Exactly. And I feel as refractive surgeons, when you are learning, there are very, very few challenging cases that we see. When you're operating under your mentor, somehow all the cases are going absolutely perfectly. And then the marking and all that you're supposed to do every day, you're doing it. But the day a traumatic flap occurs, you realize that your marking has gone somewhere else because it's so, so rare in refractive surgery. But even more important, because these are the patients who had 6x6 vision and they are not going to compromise even on one line of vision here.
Exactly. So,
Dr. Amrisha, are you there?
Yes, Dr. Vaishali.
May I just, just 30-second informal talk. Now that Nishant and Sneha, you both are there. So again, congratulations. And I was looking forward to Nishant's video because as Sneha knows very well, that his videos and presentations are just awesome. So sorry for the informal talk, but I couldn't resist myself. Hello and congratulations again.
Thank you. Thank you.
Absolutely, ma'am. Nishant's videos are always out of the box. So, Amrish sir, are you there? Okay, so I think we will wrap up the discussion on refractive surgery and over to you, Dr. Aditi, for the next talk.
Thank you, Sneha. So, coming to my favorite topic, cornea case, being presented by none other than a very dear friend, Dr. Aditya Pradhan, our go-to person for any review of literature. He's a cornea consultant in Disha Eye Hospital, Kolkata. And the expert panel is Dr. Jayanshu Sengupta, sir, a very well-known person. We all know him. We all look up to him for his surgical tips, pearls on every difficult case. He's a head of department cornea in Priyambada Birla Arvind, Kolkata. Welcome, Dr. Aditya. Over to you.
Thank you so much for the kind introduction, Aditi. So the case today will be a traumatic wound dehiscence after a full thickness penetrating keratoplasty. So I have no financial interest to disclose. So before the video, just a brief background about the case. The patient is a 32-year-old female who had a history of both a macular dystrophy. She underwent both an optical PK by my colleague. She developed secondary glaucoma in both the eyes, which was quite advanced. In one eye, she went TRAB and followed by phaco. In the other eye, she went a simultaneous phaco-TRAB procedure. And then she presented to the OPD in which she had a trauma to the right eye, either by a protruding stick or a pipe in the early hours of the morning when the light is low. So she was not very sure because she has tunnel vision. So with that, I will move on to the case. So the challenges were basically an extensive dehiscence, lots of hypotony, maybe a vitreous loss which was not clear on the slit lamp examination. The IOL was a bit decentered. Also taking care of the bleb during the surgery, the advanced glaucoma in both the eyes, and the nature of the anesthesia. So taking all of this into consideration, I decided to just administer a facial block and do the surgery under topical anesthesia itself to prevent further worsening of the situation. So as you can see, the patient is under topical, so the eye is not perfectly well centered. So by gentle coaxing and sometimes a little bit of shouting, I was able to get the eye into position for the suturing. So the key points here are not to allow much of the anterior chamber to collapse more than it already has. So again, making a side port in this scenario is difficult. So it's better to put a few sutures in place first. Yeah, now after putting sutures, I put some triamcinol into the anterior chamber to just check if there is any vitreous, after which I performed a very limited anterior vitrectomy just to get out those few strands of vitreous. So the IOL is pretty much okay in position, slight decentration, but the key is not to meddle around too much or go well beyond or below the iris plane. Try to keep it superficial, just get the tags out. The pleb was ischemic, as you can see towards the end, but there was no active leak from that, so I decided not to bother with it and leave it to my more senior and more well-versed glaucoma colleagues to take care of it at a later date if needed. So the vitrectomy is done. Yeah, so again, you put deepen the anterior chamber. Just verify the IOL is all right at the conclusion. Another key tip, as you can see, that ischemic area is where the bleb was done. The key point towards forming the anterior chamber is at the end is not to forget your side port incision. Even if it is, you can hydrate and seal it. In such cases where there is some amount of vitreous loss and it's a grafted eye, it's always better to put a single suture. It works wonders and the anterior chamber forms much better and you don't have postoperative hypotony, so to say. And it's always prudent at the end of any intraocular surgery to inject a bit of moxifloxacin into the anterior chamber, which I did. Make sure you bury all the sutures so that there is no post-op irritation or infection. So that's the conclusion of the surgery. So this was at post-operative day one, in which the case was seen by my vitreoretinal colleagues as well as the glaucoma colleagues. So the anterior chamber is well formed. You can see some form of striate keratopathy, which is expected. But with a good post-operative steroid regimen, this can be brought down. The ischemic bleb is present, which was later taken care of by my glaucoma colleagues. So this is at post-operative day 29 and the patient.
Sorry to interrupt you, but we have limited time for each presentation. So I request you to please wind it up.
Yeah, this is done. Yeah, so this is the post-operative picture at day 1 month, and the patient did regain a vision of around 6/12 with pinhole. Thank you so much.
Excellent presentation, Dr. Aditya. Wonderful surgery. May I now invite Jayanshu sir for the panel discussion?
Yeah, thanks Aditi, and beautiful talk. Aditya had done a wonderful surgery, and I would really congratulate him because of the capacity to take this under topical anesthesia and a facial flop. Probably this injury was manageable because it's very difficult to do a corneal tear with the risk of IOL prolapse and doing a vitrectomy and doing so many steps in under topical. It's a bit of a risk. We would prefer in such situations to have a general anesthesia ready for the handling this sort of cases. This is the first thing we have to keep in mind. Regarding the surgery, it's just it's basically a corneal tear, which he showed so well, plus the sutures. And in the end, he had a very good visual outcome, but not always we are lucky that day because we may have a lot of hydrodialysis and we end up with a lot of hyphema. And there's a high risk of secondary glaucoma in the post-operative period, not just immediate, but in the long run also, which is one of the factors for loss of vision patients, not to mention the high risk of graft failure and the chances of infections in this situation. I think it's beautifully done. And one important thing that he has shown is definitely if we are making any opening in these situations, additional openings, putting a suture and securing that is one of the most important things, because it helps us a lot in preventing infections or in certain other events in the post-operative period. I think that's a lovely presentation.
Thank you so much, Janshu sir, for your lovely words of wisdom. Neha, with your permission, can I ask a few of my doubts since it's Konya session?
Sure, absolutely, Aditi.
Thank you, Sneha. But Dr. Aditya, what is the intracameral antibiotic percentage that you're using in such cases? So even Janshu sir, you can also add on this.
I'm using the one which we use in the cataract surgery, that is the commercially available moxifloxacin. So no brand preferences, as long as it is preservative free, that is 0.1 cc of that given directly into the antigen.
Perfect. And the post-op regimen?
This I was a bit more aggressive because with all her past history of phacotrab and with that eye being so traumatized, and she was thankfully not a diabetic, so along with a short course of oral steroids, I put her on intensive topical prednisolone as well, along with the usual anti-glaucoma medication which she was carrying before in both the eyes.
Thank you so much. Jayanshu sir, one question for you. So as you rightly said, so the principle for all such cases will be like primary tear repair. So what we used to do in SN was that we used to do the repair and then we used to tell them that the secondary, like the any vitreal involvement or IOL involvement will be dealt with in the later stages. So once the globe is intact, a very gentle and sterile ultrasound used to be done post-op after the dehiscence has been closed up. And after that, we used to take up for further surgeries if required. So any difference in opinion?
No, true, Aditi. It depends upon the severity of the trauma. So if you do not have a lot of IOL destabilization, if this IOL haptic would have been at the wound, half out of the eye, definitely, we wouldn't be doing much. We would be just doing a toilet vitrectomy and taking the IOL out and put the graft in place. Because see, the primary goal in these situations is probably saving the graft and then going for the visual rehab in the long run. So obviously, it will become a two-step procedure in certain situations. It varies from case to case. So you cannot put in straight away that we every case we will do this. We must have that freedom of taking the decision and doing just what is needed to close the eye, because primary closure is the most important thing at this point of time.
Thank you so much, Jayanshu sir. Thank you so much. And taking time, sir is operating and still he joined us. Thanks a lot. Thank you, Dr. Aditya. Radhika, sir, if you are here, can we have one line from you regarding the session? I think sir is not there. So I think sir is not there, Sneha. Thank you so much, Dr. Aditya. Thank you, Jayanshu sir. Over to you, Sneha, for our next session.
Thank you, Aditi. So Dr. Maharshi, are you there?
Yeah. Am I audible?
Can you see me? Yes, yes. No. I can see you.
I think my net connection is quite stable today.
Wonderful. That's so right. Dr. Maharshi Moitra, he has done his fellowship in comprehensive ophthalmology as well as a fellowship in vitreoretinal surgery under some of the best VR minds. Currently, he is practicing as a freelance VR consultant in and around Kolkata. And he is going to share his experience of when a fresh pass out fellow has to manage a complicated case on his own. What is the next thing to do and how he took up the challenge? Over to you, Dr. Maharshi.
I'll start presenting. I'll start sharing my screen first.
Please, sir.
Yeah, one second. Yeah. Hello, are my slides visible?
Yes, please, sir.
Actually, it was not very much of a complication, which was not a very complicated case per se to start with. It was an inadvertent loss of an ILM flap while I was doing the macular hole surgery. The hole was actually not very small. It was a large hole. So I had planned that we will start. Could you stop the video now? I'll just 1 minute. Just I'll introduce my patient for a bit. Yeah, thank you. I'll just go ahead with that. A 65-year-old male had presented with diminished vision in the right eye for the last few months. The patient had 660 vision. There was nothing, no other significant systemic or other history. Patient had a full thickness macular hole. I just wanted to show you the OCT before going ahead. So here I can show you the OCT. There is the patient had a full thickness macular hole. So thinking of it as a very simple conventional case, we had advised the patient to undergo vitrectomy, ILM peeling and C3-8 and started to proceed with the surgery. As because the patient hole was large, we had decided that I'll put an inverse flap. I'll be doing an inverse flap for the same. Okay. I myself will try to play the video once, which if it doesn't work. I hope the video is visible. Yeah. So we started with the routine 25 gauge three-port vitrectomy. As we proceeded with the vitrectomy, and which I had previously not seen once, but not thought about much, was patient also had some inferior pigmented lattices, so which were also lasered up during the course of the surgery. Here I am just injecting IVTA, staining the vitreous, induction and inducing the PVD. Yeah, this is the one I was talking about. Is my video playing smoothly?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So after the vitrectomy was completed and the laser was done, I was just looking for the periphery also, whether there were any other breaks, because we had noticed the lattice there and lasered it up. I didn't find anything other that was significant. So proceeded with the fluid gas exchange. And did a staining. And to my surprise here, actually, I'll stop the video. I saw an unstained area, that is a negatively stained area in the center that indicated the presence of an ERM, which neither did I suspect previously, nor did I notice on the OCT. So anyways, we had to proceed with the surgery. So we started the ILM peel with the help of a ILM scratcher with a finish. So my initial plan was to do a ILM peel and an inverse flap. Here it can be seen that because the ERM is also present, it's a little bit more adhesive and sticky than I expected it to be. Here what happened is there was an inadvertent peel and there was an injury here, and you can see here while removing the thing, all of the ILM had almost come off. So I did a fluid air exchange and stained again to see if there was any ILM that was remaining or it has totally come off with the ERM. And I can see that the very small strand of ILM is there near the superotemporal area of the or the inferotemporal area rather. I extended the ILM peel. And while trying to get it off from there, inadvertently the whole ILM came off. So I was not left with anything else to put into the hole. I attempted to create a free flap. And then suddenly I noticed that one free floating flap, which was there very near the posterior pole, and by chance just held it and pushed it inside. That was not the plan of the surgery, but that was how it was managed. I do not have a post-op OCT, but eventually the patient after the surgery was doing quite well and she had 618 vision. So the day was saved for me. That's it.
Thank you, Dr. Maharshi. So to discuss this case, we have none other than Dr. Manoj Sasware. He is the MD, Sasware Eye Clinic and Omkar LASIK Center in Aurangabad. He has been providing mobile VR services to 10 districts of Maharashtra. He's the recipient of the S. Natarajan Pillai Best Paper Award. And again, one of the most favorite teachers and a wonderful human being. Sir, can I please request you to comment on this, the case which was shown by Dr. Maharshi?
Thank you, Sneha. It was a wonderful case managed by Dr. Maharshi. There is hardly anything to add as such. But as a senior, and I have done more than 500 macular hole surgery, few tips I can give to the all audience apart from the Maharshi.
Please, sir.
That you, Maharshi, you are managing a chronic macular hole case. A macular hole surgery itself is the most finest and the microsurgery in the world. Okay, the mistakes can occur, and every time it may not happen, whatever it has been decided, pre-decided. If something has been happened, there should not be one first principle is that there should not be any guilty feeling. One thing, and there we should not panic. What you have done is wonderful. Take a pause in such situation. Your aim was to tuck the macular hole with some graft.
Yes.
So now that is lost. So pause it. Again, reopen the file. Quickly see what is the age of the patient. What is the age of the macular hole? What are the findings on the OCT, even though it is known, but as a human errors, or you skip many a times because of the heavy practices. So in those cases, you have to see that what is the RP beneath the macular hole, whether it was a long-standing chronic macular flat or vertical hole, or whether the cystic changes are there, and what will be the outcome, whether it will be closed by type 1 or type 2 closure. Either whether by the time half an hour, 45 minutes are passed, you know that whether the patient will be able to maintain the position or not also in the post-operative period. Particularly yes. In chronic macular hole cases, you have to put a prolonged tamponade, and the prone position is mandatory. So in your case, you have done wonderful that job that you have extended the ILM peeling. Arcade to arcade and from disc margins and almost 2 to 3 day diameter away from the edges of the temporally on the macular hole. That is a wonderful thing. What can be added to this one is that you have to little bit massage the tips, because this was a chronic macular hole with the cup of fluid and there was an ERM also. So the edges were ragged and thick. So what can be done, that little bit of massage with the soft tip 25 gauge cannula, you can little bit massage and bring it mechanically closer. Then do the FG. First FG you have to do. As you have seen, check the periphery with depression. There were lattices, you have taken care. Again, go back. Increase the FG pressure up to 70 for a transient clearance. Quickly keep the 25 or 27 gauge soft tip cannula into the macular hole. Because it is a chronic macular hole, nothing to worry. Dry the macular hole completely. That is the key point. Dry the macular hole completely and put the gas again and give the strict 48 hour prone position. First 48. Second most important thing, that even though you have done a surgery with 25 gauge vitrectomy, most important is suture the vitrectomy port. Don't hesitate, whatever the commitments are there, because immediately post-operative period, you will see some hypotony. Hypotony will not allow the hole to close. There should be a globe should be very tight for at least for 24 hours to 48 hours. That will give you the wonderful result. And see that anyhow, this type of macular holes are going to close by secondary intention and not by primary. If at all you are very much keen to proceed and cover it or drape it with something, then there are various types of membranes available. You can harvest it. Harvest locally. You have tried it from the other ILM, and this is very difficult to harvest and put it on the drape it properly, because that also rolls out and that also is lost. That is the rule. Second thing, you can harvest the retinal tissue itself. Take a punch out graft, which Dr. Rupak is doing nowadays, but it is on table, it is not possible. You can give a larger retinal graft. People have tried and they are succeeded in giving the anatomical success of the closure of the hole. Functional, if your visual acuity based corrector visual acuity,
sir,
was
660. I would just like to mention one thing here. Dr. Rupak Kante Biswas was my mentor. I have been trained under him. I have all seen him doing all those surgeries all throughout. But I, as a beginner, did not have the courage to do that when I was faced
with that. That is okay. Anyhow, your case is best corrector visual acuity to start was 660. That was the cutoff line. Don't expect much more improvement. So all those heroic things are kept for some times. And if you lose such types of graphs, keep on attempting. One fine day you will be mastered into this procedure. Other graphs, you can take the amniotic membrane, but it is very difficult to pass through the trochar cannula, that is wall trochar cannula, and put it. That is also, there is a possibility to lose it. Another thing is people are trying anterior capsule or posterior capsule or rexes. And one more thing which is there nowadays, very popularly become PRP drops or PRP membranes, platelet rich plasma. They also can help. But all these can give you the anatomical success. I'd really wonder if any functional benefits will be there in such types of problems, particularly in case you have shown, won't be there much. So whatever you have done is a wonderful job. You have done, you have taken care of the lattices as well as the main pathology. That's all from my side. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for your input, sir. They were really helpful, sir.
Excellent discussion. Thank you so much, sir. And thank you so much, Dr. Maharshi. Can we also have a quick comment from Dr. Mandar Paranjpe, sir? Are you there, sir? Okay.
Yes, I'm there. I'm not a VR surgeon, but excellently right. managed case, Dr. Maharshi. And it's a difficult challenge, particularly if you lose the ILM. I do assist VR surgeries. So I've got a peripheral knowledge of VR. But managing with when you lose the ILM is a big challenge. But I think it was managed very well and very well summed up by Dr. Manoj.
Thank you so much.
Yes, same from me also. A wonderful surgery and excellent tips by Dr. Manoj. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
So we move on to oculoplasty next. Aditi?
Yeah. So may I now request Dr. Rituja Thomas. Ritu, are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay. So she's a very dear friend. She's been trained in oculoplasty in Narayan Netralaya. And presently, she is a consultant in Vision Eye Center, New Delhi. She is a budding and vibrant oculoplasty surgeon, has already a lot of medals and awards under her belly. And our expert panel for this session is Professor Rajendra Prakash Maurya, sir. He's associate professor in charge in ocular oncology, trauma, and oculoplasty unit of RIO, Institute of Medical Science, Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi. Sir is already chief editor of Indian Journal of Clinical and Experimental Ophthalmology, former chief editor of International Journal of Ocular Oncology, has given multiple faculty talks at various international conferences. Thank you so much. Over to you, Ritu.
Thank you, Aditi and Dr. Sneha, for having me. Really nice of you to include me in this. And as oculoplasty surgeons, we tend to not really have any mistake videos as such. We end up seeing the things post-operatively and then thinking back what could have happened. Because if you put a wrong suture, you can always cut it and put a new one. So that's oculoplasty. So I won't be presenting a single video. I'll be talking about a series of things that I learned in my now first 8 months of private practice. So here are some pre-operative challenges and things to keep in mind. So one is to always take a picture. So in case you didn't take a picture, at least WhatsApp the patient and ask them for old pictures. Because if you don't have pictures of the patient, it's very difficult to compare with what they had earlier and to justify it to the patient that you've done something which is better for them. So that is one thing which is important. It's important to take consent. Of course, litigation is an issue. But definitely, you can always rectify that by taking a verbal consent from them or talking to their relatives and getting some consent. This is very important in this day and age of practice. Now, when we're planning a surgery, it's important to follow the necessary steps and guidelines before actually going ahead. So here you can see a phenylephrine test which is negative. So we won't be planning, we'll be rather going ahead with a levator surgery for this patient rather than a mullerectomy. Whereas in this patient, you can see a positive phenylephrine test. So we can do the appropriate surgery. again, it's important to also assess patients well. Like, for example, in this patient, you can see that there is some ptosis on one side. But if you do a proper cover test, you can see that there is some associated squint as well. So these things need to be corrected. And if in case you don't know how to do something, you should get a cross consultation from a colleague so that you can complete the entire ophthalmic examination. When you get cases like this to your OPD, it's definitely very difficult for a beginner surgeon to go ahead and plan a surgery for this kind of a case. So you can either refer the patient to a more experienced surgeon or ask a, let's say, maxillofacial surgeon or any overlapping subspecialty surgeon to assist, because there can be unforeseen complications. Intraoperatively, you might have a pupil dilating on table with a orbit case. So stop what you're doing, give some systemic steroids, and then complete the case, and definitely give some post-operative steroids as well. When you're doing a ptosis surgery, if the lid height is not adequate on table, don't end the case. You can open up and check the lid height again, make them sit up if needed, and then recorrect and make it better on table, because if it's not good on table, it's not going to be good post-operatively. If you feel like you might need to adjust post-operatively, definitely give them a course of steroids. Sometimes tubes do break when you're doing a frontalis sling or you're doing a lacrimal intubation. So definitely don't use old tubes or autoclave tubes. Use brand new ones. And don't pull them, push them too much. Don't tighten them too much. And definitely keep a backup if you break a tube. Post-operatively, yes, hematoma formation, they can be drained, and ask a good history for bleeding disorders or if they're on antiplatelet medication. Worst case, you might need to drain any hematoma which forms. Definitely tag muscles while you're doing orbit surgeries, because you can definitely injure them in the process of all the surgical manipulation, dissection. If required, they may need squint surgery post-op. Transient ptosis, yes, when you're doing a lid split incision or digging deep into the orbit, you can do some nerve damage or some levator damage. So definitely steroids after surgery, dissection, and may need corrective surgery. Just one more minute. Lower lid retraction, which can happen because of poor suturing or taking the orbital septum into your suture. Definitely, you can give 5-fluorouracil, as you can see in this patient. She had some lower lid retraction, but it did improve with 5-fluorouracil injections. And like I said, sweep the fornices after the surgery. And this is a patient who I operated, and he had a good outcome, but then at the end, his tube sort of sling started coming out of the incision. So definitely get a good history of proper wound healing. You can always rebury, of course, and now he's doing very well. And in blepharoplasty patients, it's important to get the patient's psyche, understand how they are, because they do get alarmed by this kind of swelling and things like that. And of course, don't excessively dilute your Botox injection.
Please conclude your session. Sorry to interrupt. Please conclude your session, madam.
Yeah, okay, fine. All right. That's it. I'm done. And of course, the best way to learn is by teaching. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Rituja. Wonderful presentation, wonderful takeaway notes. Maurya, sir, can we have the discussion, please?
Thank you, Dr. Rituja, for a comprehensive overview of things that could go wrong when you just starting out an oculoplasty practices. It looks like you have managed multiple situations and learned well. Very important to also assess the psychology of the patient. As you mentioned, you're pursuing an aesthetic practices as well. You know, the orbital surgery is always challenging. Ptosis is again challenging, but you may face challenging situations during surgery on the table. And Dr. Rituja described such situations nicely how to handle. Thank you.
Thank
nice
you, sir. Thank you.
So much, Maurya, sir. Thanks again, Rituja. May I have a quick comment from Radhakrishnan, sir? Is he there?
I'm very
Vaishali, ma'am. Yeah, Radhakrishnan, sir, please.
Then Ashil ma'am, then we'll come to you too.
I think very comprehensive overview of all the likely problems that you're likely to have when you're doing an orbital surgery. I don't think I've got anything else to add. I think it was very comprehensive, quite extensive. And I think for a young person who's just starting off with her life, I think she has learned a lot already. So I don't think she belongs to the learner's basket. I think she should be in the consultant's basket.
No, doctor. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Vaishali,
ma'am.
Yes, again, excellent presentation. It was lovely seeing all the pictures. And one thing tip I always teach my students is which you mentioned about the MED, monocular elevation deficiency syndrome. So I always tell whenever a ptosis case comes up, I tell it's mandatory for you to do the cover test so that just find out whether it is, I mean, before touching the lid, it is important to find out whether there is a squint underlying. So that's what I was reminded of, that tip. And thank you for highlighting that, and all the best. Wonderful.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Over to you, Sneha.
Thank you so much, Aditi. I think we've had an excellent session with brilliant presentations and some wonderful discussion by our panelists. Before we close, since we have some time, I would like one closing comment from our chairpersons. So this was a session where our youngsters came and performed, and I think as teachers, all of you must be very proud because you have been guiding these youngsters so that one day they can take up the challenging cases and do these cases on their own when no one is present. So Dr. Radhakrishnan, sir, one comment from you. When the students, they are learning under you, when they are doing their MS, what more would you want them to learn? Because mostly people come up only after learning SICS or a little bit of FACO cases, but there are so many subspecialties and people have to rely on these fellowships to learn these cases. But what do you think should be the exposure to our MS students so that they can be more confident once they join the fellowships?
I think when you're doing your MS, you should be exposed to all subspecialties in some form or the other, because that will make you decide what is the subspecialty of your choice. So I personally feel that, you know, going to a good institute where all the subspecialties are taken care of should be the most important thing. Of course, that does not entirely depend upon you, but I think very important that, you know, all the specialties should be there in our institute, and that actually gives the student, you know, because how does he otherwise decide what subspecialty will he or she want to join? You know, so I think that's very, very important. Of course, nowadays with so much of online teaching, that is not much of an issue. I think you can always attend so many of these webinars that are available and learn from them and decide what is best for you. But I think the most important thing is either the institute, where I think all the subspecialties should be there in various forms so that the student knows what is best for him or her so that they can decide what they want to pursue in their future. Otherwise, I think, you know, what I've been seeing from all these presentations, I think Indian ophthalmology is in very good hands. I'm very sure about it. You know, the youngsters are doing so well, and I think it makes us really feel proud, you know, of how well our youngsters are doing. And I'm sure Indian ophthalmology is a force to reckon with today. There's no doubt about it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for those very inspiring words. Vaishali Madam, one last comment from you. Your students, when they are going into fellowships, how do you help them choose what subspecialty to take in, and basically, what are the factors they should have in their mind?
Yes, thank you, Sneha. And one tip, I'll just go on what sir has already said, that my motto throughout the 3 years when the PGs are with me, I tell them that do make mistakes. Because when you are students and when you make mistakes, we are there as teachers to correct it. And that mistake, they'll remember it lifelong. And it's easy for them to remember that, yes, this has got to be avoided. So that is one part. And choosing the subspecialty, it usually happens that if someone is with me, those students tend to like pediatric and squint more. So it is always, I tell them that it is not up to the teacher you idolize or you are with them. Try to find out where your heart is, because it's no point or where the glamour is. So if you choose what you feel you love, and it should not be a pain to do whatever you want. You should always live your passion. So that is what I advise my students. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for those lovely words. Paranthe sir, are you there?
Yes. Excellent presentations by everyone, and a lot of learning. I think what we need to develop is the keen observation skills. When we are working in the hospitals during our post-graduations, we are exposed to a lot of situations which probably when you may or may not get exposed to in your prior practice, but having that sense of observation, having and asking questions, don't be afraid to ask questions. Why a particular thing was done, and particularly with your PG guides or with your mentors, because it is that conversation which ultimately will bring out the finer points as to why a particular maneuver was attempted or done by a particular surgeon. And as far as choosing a specialty, I think one has to also take into consideration one's temperament. I'll just give an example. For example, if you're a person who likes fast cars, probably VR surgery is the wrong profession for you, because you need a lot of patience in doing VR surgeries. So probably a refractive surgery or a cataract surgery would be a better option. So know yourself well, because you're going to live with this decision all throughout your life. So don't feel frustrated after 5 years thinking that why did you choose this specialty. All the other factors are probably secondary. The money, the fame, everything else is probably secondary. But understanding yourself and how you can sustain yourself for the next 30, 35 years and love doing what you're doing for the next 30, 35 years is, I think, what you need to consider before you choose a specialty. So congratulations to AIOS for a wonderful conference, and thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you so much, sir. And one last comment from Dr. Parvez Alam, sir. Sir, are you there?
Thank you, Sneha, for this wonderful presentation. And I think all the young ophthalmologists who have participated in this program and other programs, they have really done extremely beautiful presentation, and they are very keen observers, as Radhakrishnan sir, Pranjpe sir, and Madam Vaishali Une, they told that they have done their part very nicely. There is one comment from my side that the newer generations of ophthalmologists will do very, very good. And for them, Zindabad. Zindabad, all ophthalmologists, younger generation ophthalmologists. And everything is in safer hands in coming days. Thank you. Thank you, Sneha and Adi.
Thank you so much, sir. So I think we are just in time to close this session. Thank you to the AV team for your wonderful cooperation in this. And thank you to all the panelists and speakers for making this such a brilliant session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you, Sneha. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you all the doctors and panelists and everyone who joined the session and made it so insightful and made the learnings happen through the session. The session ended right on time. Thank you for that as well. Thank you so much for joining us for the session.